Next speaker is Karan. He's going to talk a little bit about brownfield React Native apps. Brownfield, in case you're not aware, is an app where it already exists, something like a native app, and then you put React Native inside of it. He works at Skyscanner, and previously worked at Crowdfire, and he should be walking through the door any moment now, perhaps right now. There he is. Okay, he's going to come talk.
Perfect. Hey, everyone. Okay, let me not mirror displays. Okay, perfect. So hi. Today I'm here to take you through a few React Native fundamentals that I learned from working on a brownfield React Native app in the past year at Skyscanner. My name is Karan. I'm a software engineer at Skyscanner. I work on the React Native infrastructure team. So essentially, my job is to make sure that our React Native setup is maintainable and can scale for different feature teams so that they can easily adopt React Native for their particular feature and can ship those features with confidence, speed, and quality. So what are we going to cover today? First of all, I want to talk about how do you show a React Native screen actually? What happens behind the scenes? Secondly, navigation. Like every app needs some kind of navigation, and we'll look into how do you tackle that if you have a mix of React Native and native screens. Finally, I'll show you how you can use React Native widgets within your native screen and what are the basics behind that. So let's get started. Showing a React Native screen. Now, what all the code that I'm going to talk about is related to, like the code is Objective-C and the concepts are iOS related, but you can draw parallels for Android as well. It's just that I'm not really that good at Android. Okay, so every screen in React Native, every React Native screen is controlled by a view controller. Essentially, every screen in an iOS app is controlled by a view controller. Now, a view controller is essentially an instant, like a class that iOS provides out of the box called UIViewController, and you can create an instance of it in the way that is shown on the screen. And every instance of this ViewController has a property called view, and this is the view that this ViewController controls. So essentially, when you want to show a React Native screen, what you're going to do is attach your React Native view to this, to the view property of the view controller. So RCT root view init with bundle URL is something that takes the JavaScript code location, it takes your module name, which is the screen that you want to show, and the initial properties, which are the props that your component will have when it renders for the first time. And it will return a React Native view that you attach to the view controller. Now, to put it into perspective a little more, if you come from a web background, this line is essentially the same as element.innerHTML. So you take some HTML code and replace the entire child hierarchy of an element with something new. So this is what this line does. Now, let's try to unpack this piece of code. What really happens? So under the hood, when you write this line, it first starts off by initializing the bridge. So the bridge is nothing but a class called RCTBridge in React Native, and this is something that controls everything in your React Native app. So it loads your JavaScript, it parses it, it injects it into the VM, it sets up the two-way communication between JavaScript and Native, and it also sets up your native modules, which are the bridges that you write to communicate between React Native and Native. And because it does so many things, this is by far the most expensive process in your entire React Native lifecycle. Secondly, once the bridge is initialized, it creates a React Native view. This is essentially like taking your module name and creating a React Native screen from it. So the point at which you initialize the bridge is going to decide how the user experience for your app is going to be when the user goes from a native screen to a React Native screen or opens a React Native screen in the first go. So we want to make sure that this experience is as optimal and as good as possible. Now, before I tell you the different ways in which you can do that, let's look at two possible approaches and see if we can identify what is going on and what are the differences between the two techniques. So since you have looked at the video, can you notice certain differences between both? Yes? No? No? OK. So if you look closely, you'll see that the video on the left, when you tap on a hotel, there's a small loader that shows up in the middle of the screen. Whereas on the right side, you don't see that. So the loader that you see is essentially the time it takes to load like the initialization of the bridge. Now, over here, when you see it, it is literally milliseconds, because this video was taken on an iPhone X. But if you use an iPhone 5S or a low-end Android, this will be in the order of seconds. And that is not the kind of experience a user should go through every time they go from a native screen to a React Native screen. So the way we can optimize this is the left one initializes the bridge just when the user needs to go to a React Native screen, whereas in our app at Skyscanner, what we do is we preload the bridge behind the splash screen whenever the app is launched, so that by the time the user reaches a React Native screen in their journey, the bridge would be initialized, and you can directly show the screen using the module name. And like creating a RCT root view when you have a bridge pre-initialized is super, super easy. And it's not expensive at all. So how do you break down the code that we had before into two pieces? So if you want to initialize the bridge, you can explicitly create your own bridge instance, which will trigger the bridge initialization using this code. So you create an instance of RCT bridge, and you just give it the JavaScript code location, and it will start doing whatever it needs to do. And once you have that bridge instance, what you can do is you can create a root view, but this time, instead of providing the JavaScript code location, you directly give it the bridge instance that was created in the previous step. So what will happen is whenever the user taps on a hotel in that video, we already have the bridge instance pre-initialized. So the user will directly go to the new screen, which is a React Native screen. So by doing this, you can substantially improve the experience of the user, and they won't see a difference whether they go from a native screen to a React Native screen or vice versa. Next up, navigation. Like every complex enough app needs some form of navigation. So let's say, for example, you are a greenfield app. You are starting from scratch. You can choose any of the existing libraries like React Navigation, React Native Navigation. They will all work for you pretty straightforward, because this single library controls your entire navigation system. So integrating this is not at all difficult. But when you are a brownfield app, this becomes much more tricky, because every app comes with its own unique set of constraints. Every app has its inbuilt architecture, inbuilt module system, inbuilt like in-house navigation systems as well. For example, Skyscanner, we use our own custom in-house navigation system. So in such cases, integrating a third-party library becomes a huge waste of time, because it will never, ever cater to all the cases that you want, and you end up spending a lot of time trying to figure out what is going on. But let's say you do manage to integrate it, and you're happy with that, but now you have another problem. Like, you have to maintain consistency with your in-house implementation. So let's say in the future, your company decides to change its branding, or your designers decide they want, from this point onwards, the navigation bar to have a different theme, or the transitions to be slightly different. Now you have to change the code in two places, your own in-house navigation system and also the library that you're using. Because they are different implementations, you have to change it in two places now. And at one point, one of the two will lag behind, and you'll end up giving the user different experiences within the same app, which is not at all what you want. So how do you solve these problems? Now, the first thing that you need to do is figure out how navigation works in your app. Like every single app has, like every single navigation system has two possible tasks. Like it only has to do two things. One is open a screen and close a screen. There is not a lot of things that you need to do in navigation. So you have to figure out how your navigation system or how this in-house system that you use, it does the opening of a screen or the closing of a screen. And once you have figured that out, for these two possible cases, there might be variations, like you want to push a screen from left to right, or you want to push a screen from bottom to top, but they are still variations of that fall under these same categories. So once you have identified how your navigation API looks like, you can create a bridge module that exposes these in-house navigation methods to JavaScript. So essentially, when you try to navigate to a different screen from React Native, what you are actually doing is you are hooking into your in-house system, and you are using that to push the screen. So you are essentially reusing what you already have in place. So this is a small example of a hybrid app that I built. It has native screens, it has React Native screens, and you can go from native to React Native or vice versa. You can have different variations, like you can open a modal, left to right, bottom to top, and it's super hard to figure out whether you are going to a React Native screen or not. And that is the kind of experience that we want our users to have. Figuring out how your navigation looks like and bridging those methods to JavaScript is the best way to go about it. Lastly, I want to talk about reusing React Native components in your native screen. So why would we want to do that? We would want to do that for the same reason that we use React Native. We want to be able to reuse complex business logic. Let's say you are a company that has already built a complex component like a video player or an ads widget or something that is a lot more complicated for React Native as a part of an initial requirement. Now you don't want to redo the same work again when you want to implement the same functionality as a part of a native screen in the future. So having the option to be able to reuse your React Native components within your native screen is a good idea to try. So how does that work? Let's look at the basics. Now we know that every screen is controlled by a view controller, and it is an instance of a class UI view controller. It has a property called view. Now the difference comes at this point, where in our previous step, we attached our React Native view to the view property of the view controller. However, in this case, we don't replace the view with our own view. We actually append to the existing view hierarchy. So it's essentially, in web terms, it's essentially as good as doing element.append child. So you want to maintain the existing hierarchy, and you want to add your React Native view to that hierarchy. So you are essentially telling the view controller that, OK, you managed these six views before. Now you are going to manage me as well. So let's look at a small demo. So this is a native screen. And only the green button that you see is written in React Native. Everything else is completely native. And you can see that when I change things on the right, it changes that on the native side as well. Yeah. So this way, you have the option to reuse your React Native components in your native screen if you ever need to do that. There's a link to both the demos at the top. That's all I have for my talk. Thank you so much. This is my Twitter handle, and I'll share the slides later on Twitter, so keep an eye out.